off with a word of prayer. Let's bow our heads. Dear gracious Father, we are here today gathered to dive into your word, your deeper word, your loving word. So Lord, bless this service, bless this this meeting together as we explore what your church is supposed to be like. And really importantly, what we find out is the life of our leaders here, the life of leaders in church in general. So Lord, we're asking for your prayers for our church leaders. At your name we pray. Amen. Sorry, I'm a little sticky from the oatmeal raisin cookie. I can't help it. Really love oatmeal raisin cookies. So, yeah, I can understand. Now, raisins are extraordinarily sugar-packed. Then you have the sugar with the cookies and, you know, whatnot, so.
Six grapes?
A day?
Six grapes.
Oh.
A day.
Oh. So last week, we were on chapter 3, I will not let my church be about me. And we didn't finish, because like I said, this was my favorite chapter, so I pontificate and chat and speak too much about things that I like. So we're going to finish up, we're on page 39, but I felt that this was really the application, this is the important part of this particular chapter. So I felt that instead of rushing through it in 90 seconds last week, that we would finish our discussion in chapter 3 and then dive into chapter 4, because I think chapter 4 will actually go pretty quick. This is the mind of Christ. One of the best descriptions of the attitude we should embody was written by Paul in Philippians 2, 5 through 11. Philippians 2, 5 through 11, by the way, is the key verse for this entire chapter, and we're going to find out why. In fact, this is like one of the, you know, if you're going to rank Bible verses, I know, like, you know, we and Kotzen talk about this, like, how do you have a favorite Bible verse? They're all awesome. This is like, you know, top 50 of, like, on people's lists. So it's, you know, when you, 2, 5 through 11, most importantly, really, I think it's 2 through 6 in particular that it's really, that most people know. But the apostle says, cogently and powerfully, make your own attitude that of Christ Jesus. So what did Jesus do? So he's going to summarize those verses for us. We're going to read the verses. He did not consider equality with God as something to be used for his own advantage. He emptied himself by assuming the form of a slave. He humbled himself. He became obedient to the point of death, even to death on a cross. So keep in mind that Philippians 2 is not only a description of the obedience of Christ, it is an example for us to follow. We are to be servants. We are to be obedient. We are to put others first. We are to do whatever it takes to keep the unity in our church. So if we approach church membership from the perspective of entitlement, we have it upside down. You always ask first what you can do for your church. It's the whole, you know, everyone knows the JFK, you know, inauguration speech. Dave? Yes. Ask not. I can't do the Boston, Massachusetts accent, but you know, ask not what your country can do for you, but what you can do for your country. You know, so it's the same thing here at this church. Then you will have discovered the joy of being last. So, before we get into the end here, which is his pledge for chapter 3, let's read Philippians 2, 5 through 11. I have the King James Version, so there's going to be some bowing in this and whatnot, so bear with. So 5 through 11. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself, and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore God also hath highly exalted him, and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow of things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth, that every tongue should confess that Lord, that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Sound familiar, right? Those are some of the foundational verses of Christianity. Hence why it's like, you know, top. Dave, I gave this top 50 in the Bible as, you know, top 50 verses. You agree? All right, Dave gives me the approval of top 50. In fact, it's so important here that in my Bible there is a huge portion that's broken out specifically about this verse, and I'm going to read it to you now. First is the Greek word that you would find in here. The Greek word isn't here, but the Greek root of what we just read, kenosis, which is the Greek word for emptying, and is related to the verb translated here as made himself of no reputation, which literally means he emptied himself. Christ emptied himself by veiling his glory and taking on himself a true but sinless human nature and voluntarily submitting to the will of the Father. So let's try to illustrate this. At all times, Christ remained God, retaining the nature and attributes of God, but taking a human nature in order to have a ministry among men. On the few occasions when his glory was more fully revealed during his ministry, those who saw it were unable to bear it. So how do we apply this? The Apostle Paul urges that the attitude of humility, which led to the kenosis, the emptying, ought to characterize every Christian. Tall order. To empty yourself for God is to empty yourself for the church as well. So how do you be a true church member? Is to empty yourself. We even go a little bit deeper here. These famous verses substantiate the assertion of verse 5 that Jesus did indeed have with himself the same attitude of verses 2 through 4, which the readers of Paul's letters are able to maintain within themselves. Verses 6 through 8 may be translated as follows. For he, though eternally possessing the divine nature, did not regard his existing in a manner equal with God. For example, his heavenly existence or divine lifestyle as something to be selfishly maintained. He didn't hold on to being God in heaven. He lowered himself. He took the privilege, if you can only imagine what it's like to be in heaven, how about to be the God of heaven? And then to say, I will come down from that and be a man for us. But he emptied himself in that he assumed a servant's nature and appeared in the likeness of men. And having been recognized in outward form as a man, he humbled himself in becoming obedient unto death, even death by crucifixion. Being in the form of God signifies that Christ has eternally possessed the very nature of God. Just because Jesus came to live on earth for 33 days does not negate the fact. Thank you, Dave. 33 years. That doesn't mean that he hasn't been God, Alpha Omega, from the start to the end. To own the nature of God is to be God and to be equal with the other personalities of the Godhead, namely Father and Spirit. Thought it not robbery to be equal with God means that Christ decided not to continue enjoying his heavenly existence. He enjoyed the same divine lifestyle in heaven that God enjoyed. Though the Son could have lawfully maintained his heavenly existence, he did not. Rather, he assumed a servant's position and appeared in the likeness of men, consequently being judged by his fashion, his outward appearance. He was recognized by many people as mere man. But he was much more than that. He was still the Son of God, who continued to possess the divine nature. Why did Jesus willingly give up his divine existence with all its benefits and advantages? Because he had within himself the attitude of verses 2 through 4. He regarded sinners as more important than himself. That's a huge... He's God. And he found you more important than himself. And was just as concerned with their needs as his own affairs. So the Philippians were to cultivate within themselves the same attitude and express it to one another. So that was a lot of stuff to boil down to. How are you supposed to be as a Christian? How are you supposed to be as a church member, a Christian in a church? This is the example Jesus puts down on us. Dave is the pastor. He ain't so special. He humbles himself daily for his people. Dave does the same thing. Anyone, you don't even have to be an elder or a pastor or a deacon. You can just be Nanette, who lowers herself for others, no matter what her current needs may be or how important she may feel. Like, well, I'm a very important person at the church. A little bit busy. Can't deal with your kind of things you have going on. No, Jesus put the workings of heaven. I mean, he's the creator of the universe. There's a lot of stuff going on in the universe, I would say. You know, our little corner here is, you know, very complicated. How many other complicated things are going out there that we have no idea about? And yet he came here to become like us for our sins. And that's our example. So we have our pledge here on the next page. Third pledge. I call this pledge the, any Seinfeld fans here? Watch the sitcom Seinfeld. I know I'm dating myself, but it's like late 90s, you know. Love Seinfeld. But it was a particular thing that George Costanza says to, you know, to the women that he's breaking up with. And he says, it's not you, it's me. It's not you, it's me. And that's what this pledge is. It's not you, it's me. Typically, it's easier to sign a commitment on paper than it is to practice that commitment in reality. I think that's the truth. You need a fair warning before you take this third step. It won't be long after making this commitment that you will come across a fellow church member whose attitude is, well, nothing like the attitude of Christ. She will tell you what's wrong with the music, or the preaching, or the pastor, you name it. It will be tempting to chew her out, to tell her to let go of that lousy attitude, and while a gentle rebuke may be in order, you need to remember something about your commitment. This cantankerous and ornery church member is one of those you have pledged to serve. Dave, you know a few of those? In your career as well, not just your corner house, you know. My point is that these commitments are not easy. In fact, without God's power, they may prove impossible. So pray for his strength and his wisdom. And when you think you've had it with making sacrifices for others, remember the cross. As you are overwhelmed by Jesus' undeserved love for you that caused him to sacrifice everything, including his preferences, you will be able to do the same for others. That will put things in perspective. Remember, it's not you, it's me. The third pledge is pretty basic. I am a church member. I will not let my church be about my preferences and desires. That is self-serving. I am a member of this church to serve others and to serve Christ. My Savior went to a cross for me. I can deal with my inconveniences and matters that just aren't my preferences or style. Me personally, that's one of my hardest things I have to overcome. I'm busy. I work Monday through Friday, 8 to 5 every single day. I have a wife and 3 young children. My dad lives with me. And then I'm an elder here. And so, like, oh, well, I can't do that. It's like, that's not really my thing. And it's easy for me to fall into that trap because I'm so busy. I'm so busy. You know, Bill, you're the same way. Like, I have a business to run. I have multiple businesses that I run. I have family to keep in line. You know, you have young children that you're raising up as well. So you're like, well, yeah, like, if it's not right within, like, my thing, I'm going to... And see, he's exactly like, listen, I don't have the stamina of you. Oh, man. Hey, don't let the, you know, hey, I have more hair than Bill, you know, but, you know, but I'm 40 and I'm not 20 anymore. And Bill's like, oh, it'll be 40. Teasing Bill, teasing. But that is a matter for all people, all church members, to put others first, put other service first, not to just think that what you have, you're not the prince of Corner House or the princess of Corner House, the queen or the king or the duke or the earl. All right. You know, before we get into chapter 4 here, you guys know what a worship war is? I started off this chapter on worship wars. As we mentioned, it's one of the things that tears churches apart the most, the worship war. Music. But that can even go deeper. We are one of the few churches you're going to find that does a couple things in our worship service. We have communion every Sunday. How many churches have you guys been to that has communion every Sunday? Not many. Hardly any at all. We do the water baptism. That we believe in that. We have it here. Most churches these days don't even have a baptismal pool anymore. They'll build a new church and that's not even part of the church plan. Like, oh yeah. Where are we going to? Like, oh, we'll go down to the creek. Well, like, what if it's February? The creek could be frozen. The lake could be frozen. And it's going to be cold. Like, yeah. Yeah, you know, Ted's like, yeah, I'm ready to be baptized. You're like, wait a minute. No. In August. So we got baptism parties in the summer, you know. That's not... Yeah. They'll have to go outside. They'll go to, like, a pool or something like that. So there's aspects of our worship that are part of worship wars that's just ingrained in us. But as people come in, what are you guys doing? Why do you do that like that? I don't think you should do that. And then the friction starts. The music in particular. That's the hottest, you know what I mean? The drum's too loud. Drum's not loud enough. They sing like crap. They sing really great. You know, why is this? Why is this music? Why not hymns? Why not new? Why not sing songs? Why not do instrumental? Dave had someone come to his Bible study for how long was it, Dave? The instrumental guy. 2 years? 2 months? No, it was longer than 2 months. I was hearing about this for at least a year.
Because we were harping about it for long.
But this gentleman came in to tell us that we are worshiping wrong. That we are sinning because we use musical instruments on a Sunday.
You know the story, you saw the thing. There was a church that was a growing church, and had an old, the basic part of the congregation older, and there were younger people coming into the church. So the older people went to the oldest elder, complaining about the music.
Legitimate people who are part of the Church of Jesus, not Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, you know, but, Jesus people, we have to be like, okay, I can deal with that. If new people are coming closer to God, and people are getting closer to God because of the music, even though it's not my cup OT, you can deal with that. You know, like Kata, she has hymns playing in our house 24/7, because that's the music that she likes. That's going on in the house all the time. That's not really what we get at Corner House. Sometimes, we push the worship team, like, how about a hymn before communion? And they agree. You know what? We can do that. We can do a classic hymn before communion. So you guys may see that before communion, it's more of those, of a word of song. But it doesn't not get you into more of a inflective mood with that old hymn. You know, they start off usually with something new and fast-paced to kind of get you moving, and then, is it easier for the worship team to deal with people who have suggestion and want to help and join, or people who just want to gripe behind backs? I think that's kind of where the church, where were his church members? Hey, I think that if we sung this song, it would be worshipful and bring people closer to God. Dave's part of the worship ministry. I bet he'd be like, yeah, we can get that song in. We can do that. And the last question that I had on this chapter... Sunday morning is like, but on a Sunday come up here and do a concert. So, how do we overcome that? How do we overcome the differences of the music in particular? How about Dave's preaching? You know, some people love Dave. You know how many people love Dave? I hear it all the time. I love Dave. Like, really? I'm just teasing. But really, people love Dave. Like, love him. And it shocks me in Kata. Like, really?
I hear it so much. I hear it only because of Dave.
Yeah, Dave. I love Dave.
That's how the preachers like to hear it. But yet, it's either you, I'm sure.
Oh, yes.
That's how they like to hear it. Because the sad part is, you know, that means that people aren't saved if you had to move on. You know?
Right. What if Dave left? What if he got sick? What if whatever?
Just prove any preacher out there says he's better.
So yeah, are our people, does Dave have a cult of personality? He's like, no. You know, but, you know, this segues into our next chapter, because chapter 4 is all about, I will pray for my church leaders. And this is mostly a chapter about Dave. He's our minister, pastor, whatever you want to say. The word pastor is used a lot in the next chapter. But he is the leader as far as what people see. So he has a ton of different people with different thoughts and different ideas about what his job is and what he should be doing. And so specifically we're going to get into how to pray for Dave. So I guess we can hop into chapter 4. The key verse for chapter 4 is 1 Timothy chapter 3 verses 1 through 7. If you look at that chapter in particular, it is a lot of qualifiers about who can be an elder, who can be a leader, what kind of a person should they be. And when you start to read this, and if you have Dave in your mind, well, Dave's our leader, Dave's our pastor, Dave's our minister, you then start to say, well, does he fit that bill? And we hope that he does. And if he's not, well, we have to pray for him. And we're going to get into how the devil is trying to ensnare our pastor. I think we've all seen this. In 2019 was a particularly big year for prominent Christian ministers to fall from grace. And not just fall from grace, but fall into Satan's clutches. A lot of pastors that came out as gay. Others that just, you know, decided that I'm no longer a believer, and that's that, and everything I've said is, you know, fill in the blank. So 2019 was a very difficult year for Christian leadership. If you're looking around and seeing what's going on with Christian ministers and pastors. So that's why the devil in particular has it out for someone here. His name's Dave Coxon. He's our leader. So, and the devil knows how many people come here just because of Dave. So he's after Dave and does what he can to pull Dave in the wrong spot. And the thing is the devil knows Dave's weaknesses. I know a couple of them. just like little things, you know. I can, like, you know, I've known Dave long enough. I could probably, you know, push his buttons, or I could probably, like, give him a, like, hey, Dave, listen, you know, if I had to say one of your sins that you have to watch out for is this, he'd be like, you know, you're probably right about that. The devil knows way more than me. Man, he's been in Dave's life since the beginning, plotting out Dave. How am I going to get him? Because he knows Dave comes from a good family. His mommy and daddy are good Christians. I'm sure his granddaddy and his uncles. And he also from a long line of Jesus lovers, you know. So he had it out for him, you know. That guitar almost got Dave. Oh, look, he's like, you know. He knows. So let's dive into chapter 4, shall we? It's Thursday morning. Pastor Mike has a clear calendar, an aberration in his busy schedule. Actually, the calendar is not really clear. He has set aside time to finish his sermon for Sunday. His Bible is open, study aids are nearby. He begins to study. Then the phone rings. His assistant tells him about a car accident involving a family in the church. The ambulances are already on the way to the hospital. Mike leaves all his study material on his desk and jumps into the car. On the way to the hospital, his assistant calls him again. The entire Godsey family of five were in the car. None are seriously hurt except Gary, the father and husband of the family. His condition is grave. Pastor Mike walks into the emergency room. The family has just been told that their husband and father did not make it. They see their pastor and run into him sobbing in total shock. Mike is there for them. He stays with the entire family for 3 hours until he is certain enough people are around to care for them. He stops by his home to see his wife and grab a quick sandwich. It is now afternoon. He's not sure if he can return to a sermon preparation, but he knows he must. He must fight the emotional exhaustion of the morning and finish the message. But as he walks back to the church, his assistant apologetically tells him that two people need to speak with him. They consider it urgent. Aren't they all, Dave? Mike meets with the two men.